Welcome to EPG Patshala. My name is Raghuram Raju. I am from University of Hyderabad. We are doing philosophy. And the paper is Logic 1. And the topic of this module is Extreme Empiricism and Mitigated Empiricism. The author of this module is Professor Pradeep Gokhale. In the previous module, we had an elaborate discussion on Charvaka's criticism of Anumāna Pramāna. Here, let us take a minute to note the following thing. In conventional philosophical text or in the standard philosophical texts on Indian philosophy, we often come across this fact, namely, Charvakas are different from other people because they did not accept Anumāna as a valid source of knowledge, as a valid Pramāna. All other schools of Indian philosophy accepted Anumāna or inference as a valid source of knowledge. But Charvakas are different from the others because they did not accept Anumāna as a valid source of knowledge. The Charvaka did not accept Anumāna as a Pramāna, as a valid source of knowledge. It argues that there are instances where Charvakas did accept inference as a valid source of knowledge. And then we will discuss why they accepted certain forms of Anumāna, where they accepted certain forms of Anumāna. This is what is going to be covered in this module. There are modern scholars such as Devi Prasad Chattopadhyaya and Ramakrishna Bhattacharya who maintain that Charvakas did not question the authenticity of all inferences. In other words, they maintain that Charvakas accepted certain type of Anumāna and rejected another type of Anumāna. So, let us introduce a distinction between extreme empiricism in Charvakas and mitigated empiricism in Charvaka to bring this point clear. So, we are not here interested in the controversy regarding different schools of Charvakas or different versions of Charvakas. We are largely concerned with that school of Charvakas who accept certain aspects of inference and reject certain other aspects of inference, in contrast to those Charvakas who do not accept inference at all as a valid source of knowledge. So, let us begin the discussion about mitigated empiricist and look at what is the position of Charvakas. Charvakas accept perception as a valid source of inference, and mitigated Charvakas accept inference which can be eventually verified through perception. That is, they accept perception, but it is not the case that they accept only perception. There are some serious problems in accepting only perception and not accepting anything other than perception. So, for these reasons, they do accept inference, but inference for them has to be eventually or ultimately perceivable. In other words, this position is closer to the logical positivism of A.J. Ayer in his second book on logic, language and truth, where Ayer makes a distinction between verification and verification in principle, because it is not possible to perceive the past. It is not possible to perceive the objects which are not in front of us. But the past and the objects not in front of us are perceivable in principle. They are perceivable in principle. So, to come back to the point, Charvakas accept perception as a valid source of knowledge. They also accept inference, but the aspects of this inference have to be ultimately or eventually perceivable. So, this is a slightly broadens the horizon of their validity, where the domain of validity. Thus, this, while broadening the origin of perception by accepting, however, rules out very clearly the transcendental entities such as God, self or other world. This is a very important point, because if you closely read the Charvaka's position, their reason for rejecting inference is not so much with regard to the rejecting of inference per se, but their fear that if we accept inference, that will be accepting entities like God, soul and other world. So, they reject inference in order to circumvent the possibility of accepting transcendental entities such as God, self and the world. So, though not immediately, but ultimately perception is the major pramana which governs the acceptability of inference. So, this is a mitigated or a refined version of the Charvaka's empiricism. To be more precise, mitigated empiricist Charvaka's acceptance of certain types of inference as pramana does not deny the weaknesses of the inference as pramana. To reiterate the point that they do not accept inference per se. They make a selective acceptance of inference, as already pointed out. The inference that they accept is the one which should be perceivable eventually. So, they recognize the weakness of inference, but at the same time, they do not reject inference totally. In particular, they do not accept the possibility of knowing vyapti with certainty. At the same time, they are not accepting inference as a useful means of knowledge. Accordingly, we can distinguish strict and loose sense of the word pramana. Okay? Pramanas are strict, pramanas are loose. Now, Charvakas will accept perception as a strict pramana, but they will accept inference as a loose pramana. So the difference is not, the focus is not on perception or inference, but about a loose and strict pramana. For Charvakas, perception is a strict pramana, whereas inference is a loose pramana. Since inference is a loose pramana, one has to be very careful before one commits to accepting it as a valid pramana. So, in other words, they alert us to be careful about accepting inference whenever you use inference. Wherever, however, they may not do the same thing with regard to perception, they accept unconditionally. So to repeat, when Charvakas claim that Anumāna is not a pramāna, they are using the word pramāna in its strict sense. And in the strict sense, only perception qualifies to be a strict pramāna, and Anumāna does not qualify to be a strict pramāna, though it is a pramāna in the loose sense of the term. That is, a mitigated empiricist Charvaka accept a kind of inference as pramāna, they do it in the loose sense and not in the strict sense. In this way, the Charvakas have threefold attitude to pramāna. The first one is, they accept certain cognitions as pramāna in the strict sense. For example, they accept perception that way. They accept cognition of a certain type as pramāna in a loose sense or secondary sense. And finally, they do not accept certain type of cognition as pramāna even in secondary sense. For example, they do not accept inference for the existence of God as a pramāna in any case. Now the next question is, how exactly do the mitigated empiricist Charvaka distinguish between two kinds of inference, namely acceptable one in the secondary sense or in the loose sense and non-acceptable one in the loose sense? The mitigated classification of Anumāna introduces a distinction between scientific inference and metaphysical inference. Jayanta Bhatta, in his Nyaya Manjari, refers to the view that Anumāna is of two kinds, Utpanna Pratiti and Utpadya Pratiti. Now let us discuss these two different kinds of Anumāna. The inference of fire from smoke belongs to Utpanna Pratiti, whereas the inference of transcendental entities like God belongs to Utpadya Pratiti. Hence, Utpanna Pratiti as an Anumāna is acceptable as Pramāna, but Utpadya Pratiti is not acceptable. The reason is, in the first case of Utpanna Pratiti, there is a smoke and there is a fire. Both of them are physical entities. Whereas in the second case, namely Utpadya Pratiti, God is not perceivable. God is not perceivable. That's why they don't accept Utpadya Pratiti. Jayanta Bhatta attributes this view to which he calls more learned Charvakas. He calls them learned Charvakas or a refined Charvakas. In Tattva Sangraha Panjika, Kamalasila quotes Purandara's statements and says that Charvakas do admit Loka Prasiddha Anumāna, but the kind of Anumāna which is made by transcending the worldly way is denied by them. Let us look at the difference between Utpanna Pratiti Anumāna and Utpadya Pratiti Anumāna as referred to by Jayanta. Utpanna Pratiti literally means that which is experienced in the past. So, something is experienced in the past and it is inferred now. Utpadya Pratiti, on the other hand, means that which is yet to be experienced. We don't have an experience of that. For instance, we don't have an experience of God. So, that's called as Utpadya Pratiti. Though these two different terms are used as the adjectives of Anumāna, they need not be taken as two aspects of Anumāna, but one that is acceptable, whereas the other is not acceptable. That is, to reiterate, that both Utpadya Pratiti and Utpanna Pratiti, Anumāna, have something in common. They are adjectives of Anumāna. Since they are adjectives of Anumāna, we should not make mean that they are attributes of Anumāna. If they are attributes, then you know we have to accept both of them. That is not the point. The point is that they are two different qualities of Anumāna. One is accepted, the other one is accepted. That is, the term Utpanna Pratiti and Utpadya Pratiti should be taken to characterize the object of Anumāna, that is, the sadhya of Anumāna and not Anumāna itself. That's the point. Of course, when you say that the object of inference in the case of Utpanna Pratiti is already accepted, and in the case of Utpadya Pratiti, it is not already experienced, as is the case of God, we are not committing to use type token distinction that the same object in token sense is experienced in one case or not experienced in another case. That's not the kind of thing that we are maintaining here. What is maintained here is that there is something that is inferred but that is already perceived earlier. In contrast, there is something which is yet to be perceived. Okay, I have perceived some, or somebody has perceived instances from the history, but the perception of God or experience of God is not there. Even in the example of inference of fire from smoke, what is the kind of Utpanna Pratiti Anumāna? We have not experienced before the specific fire item that we are inferring, but we have experienced some fire item or fire in general, for example, in the kitchen. In other words, that in inferring the fire from smoke in the forest, the fire in the forest is not experienced by us. What is experienced by us is another instance of a fire in the kitchen and fire experience of a fire in general. But what is common to all of them is that all three are fires. So I experience, I infer one fire that I don't perceive from another fire instances that I have perceived. In Utpadya Pratiti Anumāna, on the other hand, as already noted, the object of inference is not experienced before, even in type sense. For example, the inference of the existence of God. We have neither experienced before the God that we are inferring, nor have we have experienced some other God or God in general. That is the difference. That is the idea Charvakas seems to be maintaining. Hence, when the object of Anumāna is already the object of one's experience, the Anumāna is called Utpanna Pratiti. And when an object of Anumāna is not the object of one's experience, the Anumāna is called Utpadya Pratiti Anumāna. In other words, we can say that the object of Utpanna Pratiti Anumāna, since it is experience type, is an empirical object. As against this, Utpadya Pratiti Anumāna, the object of Anumāna is not experience type and hence is a non-empirical object. The distinction will be roughly between the inference, the conclusion of which is verifiable, and that the conclusion of which is not verifiable. That if I say that there is a fire on the forest because there is a smoke, I can verify whether there is a fire or not. But when somebody says there is an existence of God, then we can't verify that. For the sake of brevity, we will call the inference with verifiable conclusion as verifiable inference, and we will call the inference with non-verifiable conclusion as non-verifiable inference. That is, one inference can be verified, as in the case of a fire in the forest that is inferred from seeing the smoke, but the non-verifiable inference is the existence of God, soul or other world. The term utpadya pratiti literally means that the experience of which is to be generated. Here, utpadya to be generated as the adjective of pratiti, which is experience, can simply mean that it is to be generated through the inferential cognition itself or through some other alleged means of knowledge such as the verbal testimony. But it does not mean that we will know it by pratyaksha. That means we cannot perceive God. We will be forced to accept God either through inferential cognition, which is objected by Charvakas, or merely accept it because of verbal testimony, which is again rejected by Charvakas. In the argument for the existence of God, for instance, God, which is the object of Anumāna, is not something we have already experienced or what we are likely to experience. But the experience of God in the form of its inferential judgment is something we are going to generate without experiencing, without perception, and through other means such as verbal testimony. But it does not mean that we will experience God in future by pratyaksha. The Charvaka's classification of Anumāna just discussed has parallels to other schools of Indian philosophy, such as Vaisheshika's classification of Anumāna into Drishta and Samanyatodhishta. In fact, the threefold classification of Anumāna presented by Nyayikas and Sankhya as Purvavat, Sheshavat and Samanyatodhishta have all been discussed in the previous other modules, can be interpreted as an expansion of the twofold Vaisheshika classification. In fact, logically speaking, Drishta and Adrishta, verifiable and non-verifiable, can be regarded as two basic types of Anumāna, and other classification can be arranged around them. The major difference between the classification of inference that Vaisheshikas, Nyayikas and Sankhyas are presenting or classification of inference which are all acceptable to them. They accept inference as valid source of knowledge. But the classification, on the other hand, that Charvakas are presenting, though formally similar to these classifications, is meant to be the one between acceptable and non-acceptable inference. In other words, all other schools of Indian philosophy accept Anumāna and they also classify. It is Charvakas who discriminate between what is to be accepted in Anumāna and what is not to be accepted in Anumāna in their classification. Some examples of non-verifiable inference are, as already pointed out, the arguments for the existence of God. The well-known formulation of the inference for the existence of God is the following. Trees, mountains must have a creator because they are products, like a pot. With reference to this inference, we can say that we have seen the creator of a pot, namely the potter, whereas God is not the same type of object as the potter, but it is different in many important respects. In this case, potter is not an instance of what we want to prove, unlike fire in the kitchen, which is the perfect instance of the fire on the wall. That is, I can perceive a potter whom I infer from the pot, but I cannot perceive a God who is inferred as a creator of this universe. That's why Charvakas make a very important distinction between an instance and an analogy. Instance and an analogy. In the traditional Indian form of inference, Drishtanta is given in order to substantiate Vyapti. If Drishtanta is of the same type as the object of inference, then it can be called an instance proper. If, on the other hand, it is only similar to the object of inference but does not belong to the same type as that, then drishtanta is just an analogy and not an instance. For example, in the inference of fire on the hill, the object of inference, and the fire on the kitchen belong to the same type, namely fire. Hence, fire in the kitchen is the instance for the fire in the hill. But in the inference for the existence of God, the drishtanta, namely potter, is not of the same type of entity as God. It is only similar to God in some respect, but dissimilar to God in so many important respects. Hence, potter in this inference is just an analogy for God and not an instance. As a result, the object of this inference is not something of the same type as we have seen before, but it is a new type of object, something we are presenting before us through this inference itself. In this sense, the inference of God can be called as type-crossing inference. Now let us take the other argument from Sankhya. Sankhya establish the existence of Purusha. The things such as visual sense organs are meant for Sankhya, for something other than them, because they are composite in nature, Sanghata. All composite things are meant for something other than themselves. For example, the things like bed are not meant for themselves, but for people to use them. In the above argument, the distinction between composite, made of parts, and non-composite, partless, is of crucial importance. Sankhya maintains that prakriti, the primordial nature, and its manifestations are composite in nature, and they are active for the sake of Purusha, the soul, which is non-composite. The sense organs, motor organs, and other parts of our personality do not operate for themselves, but for the sake of the soul. This being argued in the above argument. Here, Purusha as an essentially non-composite being is intended to be proved, but this nature of Purusha is not stated in the argument itself. That is because the general rule, vyapti, on which the argument is based is substantiated by the examples like bed and seat, where these things as well as the being for which they are meant are all composite. This in fact makes the argument problematic. Dinnaga, the Buddhist logician, refers to this inference as an example of the fallacy called the reason destroying the intended probandum, which he includes under viruddha, which is contrary reason. The fallacy occurs when the reason property does not imply the intended target property, but the opposite of it. In the present case, compositeness is the reason property, and the condition of being meant for some other things is the target property. For the example such as bed, seat, etc., it is clear that the some other thing for which they are meant are also composite. Hence, vyapti statements assumes the form, every composite thing is meant for some other composite thing. So in the case of sense organs, the some other thing for which they are meant must be composite. But this is contrary to the intended target property, namely the non-composite Purusha, for whom sense organs are supposed to be meant. Charvakas would agree with this criticism of this inference. They would further say that all non-verifiable inference commit this fallacy. That is because they intended to prove something non-empirical on the basis of empirical evidence. The purely negative inference of the existence of Atman is another issue with regard to inference. We have seen in the previous module that in the later development of Nyaya logic, Anumāna was classified into three kinds as purely positive, purely negative, positive negative. The argument for the existence of Atman given by Keshava Mishra the author of Tarkabhasa, as an example of purely negative inference, is also a kind of non-verifiable inference. It is as follows. The living bodies of being must be possessing Atman because they possess the act of breathing, etc. We have here, according to Nyayikas, only negative concomitants of the type whatever lacks Atman does not possess the act, such as breathing, for example, pot, cloth and rock. We do not have positive concomitants of the type whatever breathes possesses Atman, because although we have seen many breathing things before, existence of Atman, which is itself being argued for in this inference, has not been experienced before. When the more learned Charvakas are opposing non-verifiable inference, their opposition will apply to Kevala Vetireki Anumana of the above type also. Now, let us look at what are the advantages of the classification. With the help of this classification, Charvakas have enormously succeeded in defending the empiricist position and getting rid of otherworldly metaphysics advocated by dogmatists of the other schools. This position of Charvaka is close to logical positivism of the West, for whom the statements about the so-called metaphysical reality are not false but nonsensical. Charvaka seems to be advocating strong scientific method. However, there are certain clear difficulties in this classification, and they are the following. Though the above classification helps Charvakas in rejecting the speculative arguments of the entities like God, soul, it makes them reject many other things which they may not want to reject. And what are they? Take for example the existence of sense organs. Though perception becomes possible because of sense organs, hence we have to accept their existence, sense organs themselves are not perceivable. Now, if you look at this problem, we will also see parallels, similar problems in Western philosophy. For instance, it is argued that logical positivists have come up with verification principle. But the question that is asked is verification principle verifiable? Similarly, there are questions that is asked about falsification of Karl Popper, falsifiability. And the question is raised, is falsification falsifiable? Can we falsify the falsification principle? So, this is a problem that surrounds all absolute claims. All absolute claims. Similarly, one has to accept the movement of planets and even the phenomena like other minds, space and time. Though they cannot be known by perception, they exist. And we have to accept them through inference. According to common understanding, though Charvakas reject otherworldly metaphysics, they are the defenders of common sense and belief in space, time, other minds, sense organs and the movement of planets is a part of common sense. Hence, it is possible that all mitigated empiricist Charvakas were not favorable to the strict classification and they preferred to classify inference in a way more open to commonsensical reasoning. This brings us to the second classification of inference, namely Loka Prasiddha Anumana versus Loka Atita Anumana. The second classification is Loka Prasiddha Anumana versus Loka Atita Anumana. We have seen that according to Purandara's statement quoted in Tattva Sangraha Panjika, Loka Prasiddha Anumana is acceptable to Charvakas, whereas the one transcending the worldly way, Laukika Marga, is not. We can conveniently call the later type of Anumana as Lokatita Anumana. This dichotomy is sometimes expressed in a different way as the one between Loka Prasiddha Hetu, Tantra Siddha Hetu. This later formulation is attributed to Charvaka thinker Udbhada Bhatta in Syavada Ratnakara. Now the question is about understanding the meaning of the term Loka Prasiddha Anumana. Two possible meanings of the term Loka Prasiddha Anumana can be considered in this context. Loka prasiddha can mean strongly established within the framework of the worldly way of life. Here the term loka is related to this worldly or secular way of life, and the term prasiddha means strongly established. In other words, loka prasiddha anumana is an inference which proves something within the framework of this worldly way of life. In this sense, loka prasiddha anumana can be contrasted with the inference which transgresses the worldly way, laukika marga. The word laukika marga means a way of life which accepts this world as real, that is, this worldly way of life. This meaning is consistent with Charvaka's denial of other worlds. Loka prasiddha can also mean strongly established in the world or commonly acceptable by the people at large. This meaning should not be confused with another possible meaning, popular or acceptable by people. Charvakas do not accept everything that is accepted by convention, by ordinary people, because there is a serious problem in accepting everything practiced by people, because people do accept karma, God and other world. Simply because there are people who accept these things does not make Charvakas to accept that since it is accepted by common people, loka prasiddha, they should accept the things like karma, God or other worldly. So in other words, they do not accept everything that is practiced or believed by common people. So by loka prasiddha anumana, they mean what we can be or should be accepted by people on rational grounds, not what is generally accepted by them. In this sense, loka prasiddha anumana can be contrasted with tantra siddha anumana. Here, tantra means a metaphysical system, and a metaphysical system that is accepted by people is not acceptable to Charvakas. Every metaphysical system has its own framework of presupposition, and there are inferences and doctrines which are said to be proved in that framework. Since those inferences and doctrines are based on the system specific presuppositions, they are not commonly acceptable irrespective of the system. In other words, they are system specific. By clubbing the above two meanings of the term, we can say that loka prasiddha anumana is an inference strongly supported within the framework of this worldly way of life and is worthy of being commonly acceptable by people at large irrespective of presuppositions of any metaphysical system. Loka prasiddha anumana is not a singular term. It can have different types of things in this, and they include 1. Inference based on empirical generalizations which give high probability of conclusion though not certainty. The conclusions of these inferences should be verifiable. 2. The inference based on logical or conceptual necessity. For example, this must be a tree because this is a simsapa. 3. Common sense inferences involving explanatory necessity or pragmatic necessity. Inferences regarding the existence of space, time, other minds, matter, which follow from our daily life by way of explanatory necessity or pragmatic necessity will be covered by this. All these types of inferences go into explaining and justifying the worldly practices. The opponents of Charvaka are interested in Anumana Pramana for preservation and justification of worldly practices as well as otherworldly dogmatic beliefs, whereas Charvakas are interested in accepting Anumana only for the worldly beliefs and rejecting the otherworldly beliefs. Here the preservation of worldly practices or based on common sense becomes not only a purpose but also criteria and a regulating condition of the acceptability of inference for charvakas. So to conclude, on the one hand, charvakas begin their epistemological enterprising by accepting pratyaksha perception as the only authority. But there are some learned charvaka thinkers who realize the importance of anumana as a useful means to knowledge, though not as an authority. They expressed readiness to allow verifiable inference as pramana, but denied the status to non-verifiable inferences. These charvakas appear as the strong advocates of empirical sciences in general and verifiability principle in particular. But there are other charvakas who are concerned more with the justification of common sense. They were interested in constructing an epistemology which would support the broad framework of our life in this world. They did this by allowing what they called as loka prasiddha anumana, which roughly means commonsensically acceptable inference. The views of these charvakas can be interpreted as suggesting that we should not accept inference unless they are supported by common sense view of the world, which involves a kind of pragmatic necessity and the violation of which amounts to pragmatic contradiction. The inference for God, Atman, other world do not possess any such necessity and hence they are not to be accepted. Inference limited by common sense view of the world, such as inference about matter, other minds, space and time, can be accepted insofar as they involve a kind of empirical pragmatic necessity. In fact, in this framework, charvakas are always concerned with the question of the dividing line between common sense metaphysics and transcendental metaphysics. What is empirically, practically necessary and what is not so necessary? For instance, accepting consciousness in the case of both ourselves and others is necessary for empirical, practical view of life. But accepting substance called mind or soul, which has consciousness and which exists independent of body, is not necessary. Accepting emergence of the present world from some material causes is practically necessary, but accepting God as the cause of this world is not necessary. Though accepting the empirical world is necessary, accepting a trans-empirical world, which one reaches after death, is not. Similarly, the existence of living beings within their empirical lifespan is acceptable, but their existence before birth or after birth is neither empirically nor practically necessary. To conclude, let us relook at the broad claims of this module. The module can be seen as beginning with the statement that charvakas accepted only perception and they did not accept anything that is non-perceptible, including inference. The second point that comes to our mind is that there are some charvakas who saw the limitations in accepting only perception and they saw that there are some modes of inference that are acceptable. So they thus extended the purview of their theory of knowledge by accepting, along with perception, some aspects of inference, and those aspects of inference that they accepted concern this worldly. They rejected the inferences that ascertain the other world, which is non-perceptible. Let us end this module by bringing an important controversy that is outside this module but can throw some light on this module. That while it is true that the module discusses the relation between pratyaksha and anumana, that is perception and anumana, it is important to note that the people who rejected Charvakas more or Advaitins? Charvakas accept perception. Advaita does not accept perception as a reliable source of knowledge. Perception is part of Maya. So that is another angle that one can think while discussing epistemology and logical aspects of Indian philosophy. Thanking you.